Hi guys, welcome back. This is Matt Chet, episode 432, featuring part two of my interview with the great George Ziets, RPG designer extraordinaire. This part of the interview, we talk about his early days, the stuff he was doing back when he was 9 years old. I think we go about that far back. We talk about his love of the adventure construction set on the Apple II. And we also talk about his first big commercial project, Earth and Beyond, for Westwood. It's an MMO. Talk a little bit about that before getting into Neverwinter Nights 2, and as well as Baldur's Gate 2 and Strongholds and Stretch Goals. And basically, how much should you try to pack into your RPG? At what point does stuff become redundant and sort of half-assed? And what effect does that have on sales? We even talk about that, the timing of your releases. So a lot of great stuff here for developers, designers, as well as just fans of role-playing games. So a lot to cover. So without further ado, here is Mr. George Ziets.
Let's talk a little bit more about your early days, even before then. Like, I always loved this stuff, just, you know, how people got their creative spark and what made them want to pursue this this career. So I was reading about you go all the way back to the age of 9,
and you were playing... Even early, technically.
Oh, even before then, maybe, but playing Dungeons & Dragons, I saw you had the original Red Box.
Mm-hmm.
But I was kind of intrigued by this. I don't know if I've had anybody talk about this before on this show, but you were working with Stuart Smith's Adventure Construction Set.
Oh my God, yeah.
And that was the Apple IIe, and I just think that's a very special era.
Yeah,
I talked to so many people that, you know, they had Apple IIs and they were doing stuff like this. So I just wonder if you could talk a little bit more about this experience on the ACS.
So ACS, I will sing its praises until the day I go off
Stuart
the game
Smith,
designer.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's this is before the days of our, like, you know, RPG Creator and like all this stuff that there is now. This is before Bard's Tale construction set, if you remember that.
Oh yeah.
So this is like the era of Ultima, like maybe Ultima 3, Ultima 4, which, like, those were my games back then. I loved the Ultima series. And Adventure Construction Set let you make games that were very similar to that. They sort of were in that cusp between Ultima 3, Ultima 4. Like, it was those little characters, like, moving around on the screen. Mm-hmm. You know, nothing was really moving. But you could make characters that looked a lot like Ultima characters, and you could make, you know, they could build little walls and bridges and everything else, and you had an over map that you moved around. There were random encounters. It was super cool, and, like, it felt like, hey, I can make my own Ultima. And it taught you the fundamentals of being a game designer. Like, I didn't think about that back then, but you know, I made game design documents. Like, before I sat down to do Adventure Construction Set modules, I would create documents and I would draw maps on graph paper and say, okay, this is what's going to happen here. Here's the little quests that are going on. So you created the documents and you implemented it and you tested it. And then I forced my friends to play it. so you actually, you're actually getting to sit there. It was almost like, you know, primitive YouTube, right? Where, like, I'm sitting there and watching them play through. I'm like, oh, look at that. He missed that thing. Or, you know, this part, he's kind of bored. And you're learning game design that way. It was an incredible way to, like, learn the basics of the craft. And it helped me a lot when I got into the industry. Like, I think I knew things based upon that I wouldn't have known otherwise. So it was a lot of fun. I hope it was fun for my friends playing.
Do you remember any of the adventures you created back then? Or the characters?
Oh God. I mean, a lot of them,
some of them ended up in your later work somehow, would be my guess, right?
Not really. No? Actually, a lot of them ended up as passwords. So, like, one of the greatest passwords that you can use on, or greatest passwords that you can use on your stuff, or on, like, your banks or whatever, is, like, characters and stuff that you made up when you were a kid, like these nonsense words that no one else is ever going to know. So they certainly are passwords. I don't know if there's a whole lot. Like, back then I was essentially making Ultima clones. And they got better as time went on. I mean, my early ones, I was a kid, so they were pretty simplistic. But
kill the rats. See, I would have
yeah,
been happy.
Yeah, there were rats. But you know, one of the things that I did, I don't think I had ever seen it before. One of my adventures, I was like, I got this great idea. We're gonna start the player in prison. Like, yeah, I had never seen that before. So I was like, this is new. And then of course, like, everyone does that now. But stuff like that, where like you're thinking of these ideas way back then, that you know nowadays are sort of commonplace. But you know, back then they felt like these amazing original ways of starting games or going or coming up with great characters or whatever. So yeah, those were good times. I still have those around someplace. Like, it would be on a disc, and it was so simple.
Are you still got these games around somewhere?
Oh yeah, they're in my basement.
Oh, you have to find them.
I do. So they are.
Do you have an Apple II that's ready to run?
There's an Apple II. Last time I tried it out was around 2000, 2001. So maybe it still runs.
Well, I think those things were built to withstand a nuclear war, right? They.
Yeah, you might be right. The only problem is the discs. Like, I don't know whether the floppy disks would still hold up, but the floppy disks, like the way they had it set up. You would make your adventure and you would save it on a disc, but what as you were playing the adventure, it would change what was on the disc. So you had to make sure that like you kept your master copy with like your adventure on it, and then you would copy that, and then someone could play on the copy, because as they're going through, like they're changing what's there. So like if you just took your master copy and let someone play it, your adventure would be gone. Like the characters you put in would be dead or whatever it was, and you would have just completely busted up the adventure that you had made. So it was very, very primitive, but it was, for back then, it was fantastic.
And there is a question for you, George. So I'm thinking about when you were 9 and you playing ACS and D&D with all your friends. What if you were 9 today?
Oh my God.
Do you think would you be drawn to like Unity or RPG Maker? Or do you think that time has passed?
No, I think like I would have been drawn to something like RPG Maker. I don't know, like I've never been a super techie guy. Like I can do basic, or I certainly understand basic programming, but I was not a programmer. I mean, my first adventures were like, this is even before 9, like playing arcade games, and then like I would go home and like, I'm gonna make that game or a game like that, and then I would like draw little characters and like cut them out and create screens and have them moving around and stuff. It's like I was much more just do it, just get in there. Like I don't really care about like learning how to do spreadsheets or something. Like I just want to make a game. So RPG Maker I think would appeal to me a lot, where you can just jump in there and you just start making stuff and creating stories and characters. I think that's probably what I would do now.
Well, sometimes I worry about nowadays there just being such an abundance of tools, and kid just gets overwhelmed. Sometimes I think you might actually have been better off with something like Adventure Construction Set, so you didn't feel like you got this fire hose of content coming at you. I don't know, maybe that's completely wrong though.
No, I think you're right. I mean, the other like the extension of that is it is so much harder to get into this industry nowadays. Mm-hmm. I mean, like if you look at all the game design college and graduate programs that are out there, like there's a lot of kids. It's sort of like, instead of starting a band, like the kids when I was in high school, it was like, we're going to start a band. Like nowadays, it's we're going to start a video game company. And that literally seems to be like the new band is like starting a video game studio. There are so many really smart like young people out there who are going into these video game programs and want to get started and making indie games. It is so hard with all that competition for them to get into the video game industry nowadays. Like, I try to help, especially around here, like I try to help people out and give them advice and stuff. But wow, it's a lot tougher than when I was getting started.
Yeah, I know you said at one point that you're worried about the abundance of RPGs. Actually, so you say here, you're actually worried that there might be a burnout.
Yeah.
I think it's just too much of a good thing. Or is it?
Yeah, I think I might have been talking specifically about the ISO RPGs. There's like a lot, like around 2012, 2013, there was sort of that like Kickstarter revolution, and all of a sudden we're making Wasteland 2 and Pillars of Eternity and Torment. And then there was like all these indie games that were coming out, and you know, another ISO game, and then we got Shadowrun, and we got all these other licenses that are coming out. And there's just so many ISO RPGs now that even I have a hard time like keeping track and playing them all. And I'm in the industry. And I think there is a certain amount of like, oh, you know, yawn, another ISO game. You know, I've already got like six in my backlog I haven't played yet. Yeah. So.
Yeah, I think that's the. I wish they could be spaced out a little more, so you get have time to get tired of one game before there's like two other ones that you feel obligated. It's like that's the key. You almost feel obligated to try out these new games instead of being excited and wanting it.
Yeah. No. I mean, and that kind of gets back to what you were saying, where maybe 15, 20 years ago when we were kids, like. There were maybe like two or three games a year mm-hmm. that like we were interested in playing. And like, I would sit down, I would play Ultima 5 for like an entire year.
Yeah.
Like, never happens anymore.
You'd have enough time to play it all the way through a couple of times before the new thing was out.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I mean, that, and that's completely different. Now it's like, can I get through this game in 2 weeks so I can get
Exactly.
Like, that just happened with Stygian, like the Cthulhu game that came out. There were some guys, I think they're in Turkey, like, super excited guy, like I really felt like those were kindred spirits, and they put out this the Stygian game, and then that's 2 weeks before Disco Elysium. It's like, ah, because then I gotta, you know, I gotta try to get through this before Disco Elysium comes out, and then there's more stuff, and like Outer Worlds is coming out in like a few weeks. It's just really hard to keep up.
Yeah, I wouldn't want to release a game right now in the midst of all this.
No. And it's hard to plan it too, because a lot of times you're like, okay, we're starting this game. You don't know what else is work people are working on right now. And there's 2 years. It's going to take us 2 years to do it. And then just 3 months before you're ready to ship, you find out, oh, Outer Worlds is coming out at the same time. Oh, there's another Elder Scrolls game coming out a week after we were planning to ship.
Uh-oh. Yeah. Yeah, that's. I've talked to a few people that got trapped by the like you said, they didn't plan it that way, but what can you do? You got all this. Once the apparatus is in motion, it's kind of hard to stop and say, well, we better wait for the hype to die off this other project.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, and it's even, if you're indie, it's a little easier because you can be like, well, we can be a little flexible. Mm-hmm. If you're working at like In Exile, Obsidian, and you have a publisher, or you've got, you're owned by Microsoft, like, you're at the mercy of the publisher's financial schedule for the year. And if they're like, we need a game third quarter, I mean, I've seen that happen where it's like, sorry, this has to come out. It's too bad. You know, Skyrim's coming out the same, you know, the same month. The way it goes.
Well, that won't have any impact, right?
Yeah. I mean, I've seen games, and it happens the other way too, where like they'll say, well, you know what, because of financial business stuff, we can't ship your game. Even though it's done, we're not going to ship your game until March of next year. And so sometimes people were like, how come that game didn't come out? You know, we've been waiting for this thing for 3 years. Well, sometimes it's the game is done, but the publisher says we can't ship it until first quarter 2020. And that's how it is. And there's nothing you could do. And you can just sort of smile at the fans and say, we're still working on it. And, you know, maybe it's in the can and you're working on something else. But, you know, it's just the publisher says it's coming out at that point.
Thus, Digimancy. I wanted to bring us back briefly to Earth and Beyond. You know, this is, I never played that. I have to say I'm kind of ignorant about the game, but I was reading about it and getting more and more intrigued by the minute. You know, it sounded like it had a lot of promising ideas. Plus, it was a space setting, you know, which is not a lot of those, mm-hmm. even today. I'm just, you know, wondering what happened there? Why didn't that take off? And, you know, I found a quote that I think you would find humorous, maybe. Or maybe sad, I don't know. But Justin Calvert had interviewed some people at EA at the time about why we're canceling this game. Mm-hmm. And the response from an anonymous EA executive. Quote, games based on medieval fantasy have done very well. Other genres have not. So I was thinking, just kind of knowing about you and your thoughts on this, that must be really galling. For you to hear something like that.
I don't know about galling. I think it's just wrong.
Yeah.
Like, I think the problem with Earth and Beyond was not the genre. There were a lot of problems with Earth and Beyond. I think the team we had was great, and we had a lot of really smart people working on it. There were a number of things that sort of conspired to kill Earth and Beyond. One thing I always tell people, I have the honor, I think, of working on the first MMO ever to be canceled, which is like, yeah. We might have been beaten by Motor City Online, which, I mean, I guess that makes sense. But we were like the first big kind of fantasy sci-fi MMO to be canceled. So a lot of things happened on that project. That even before I got there, that project had been in development for a number of years.
Yeah, this is well before World of Warcraft and.
Oh my God!
EverQuest, I'm not. Was it before?
EQ was out already.
In fact, it was out.
We were saying we are going to be EQ in space.
Okay, EQ in space.
That was the vision. The problem was like there were a lot of cooks in the kitchen on Earth and Beyond. EA had bought Westwood. So you had the Westwood owners, you had some senior people who'd been at Westwood for a long time, you had all the executives at EA who would sort of come cycling in and look at the game and say, we should do this with it, we should do some other thing with it. You had marketing. So there was just like all this different, all this feedback and all these like, change this, no, we should be doing that.
I can just imagine that the eye rolling that must have been happening at the...
Oh, it was rough. I mean... We felt like, you know, it was like this tug of war and here's the team in the middle and we're like, we have some ideas, shut up. There was a lot of like restarting and changes of direction. When I got there, it had been in development for a number of years. It had changed a bunch of times. Systems were still not really in place. Content was really just getting started. We had a setting, but we really hadn't made a whole lot of quests or anything yet. I got in there around the same time they were ramping up a lot of people. We had about a year to make an MMO, all the content for an MMO. But about 6 months or so in, we were rolling, making lots of content. We felt pretty good. And then some executives came in and they were like, we don't really like this story that you guys are doing. I think instead of it being about these human factions, we think it should be an alien invasion of human space. So the poor lead writer, she was an offsite woman in Connecticut. Like, she's like, well, okay, that story. So 6 months to go on production. Jeez. She has to tear up the story, remake it. All the story content had to go out and down the toilet. A lot of quests and levels and stuff had to be significantly changed. So we spent the next 6 months... fixing all that stuff from the big story change and remaking everything. Obviously, there wasn't enough time to actually make enough content for the game. So we were told, focus on the first 15 hours. Like, make the first 15 hours of the player experience fantastic. And we did that. And we actually got a lot of really good buzz when the game came out for the first 15 hours. And then there was nothing to do. So it was like, you get sucked in the first 15 hours of the game, and then it's like, well, thanks for sticking with us. Have fun farming mobs in the rest of the game.
That's certainly not the only MMO to end up like that.
No, at that time it was very common. But like, there was very much a feeling of like, every MMO ships in a crappy state. So it's okay, don't worry about it. And then of course World of Warcraft came along and they shipped in a really good state. And then they blew everybody else out of the water.
All right, so after this, at some point, you joined Obsidian to work on Neverwinter Nights 2. And I know everybody wants to hear about, you know, the expansion.
Sure.
Mask. I mean, of course, we'll get there. But I just wanted to talk a little bit first about just Neverwinter Nights 2. You know, you're coming to this company. You've had this dream about working on Infinity Engine games. It seemed like this might be the closest opportunity that you would get to that. And then later after this, you'd said that Neverwinter Nights 2's biggest sin was probably the ambition. Mm-hmm. The team trying to do too much, too little time. Awfully common story. And I had Trent Oster on before this. That. He's saying the same thing about the first Neverwinter Nights. So.
Yep.
I mean, what? I don't know if you have more to add to this or just yes.
Well, no. So, I mean, It is a very common thing. Like, I saw Trent talking about that. He's absolutely right. Like, and there are some other games I suspect we're going to be talking about in this interview that it was exactly the same problem. So it is unfortunate that, like, we as game designers, it's fortunate and unfortunate that we as game designers are super, like, passionate, excited people were like, we want to do all this cool stuff. I got this great idea for a new system. And so coming into Neverwinter Nights 2, it was a very big story. There was a lot of like new systems and things that they wanted to do. And then the tool set on top of all that, the tool set incidentally kind of got short shrifted, which was unfortunate side effect of having so much focus on like all this other new stuff they wanted to do. But it was a very ambitious design. Eventually, Josh Sawyer got called in to, there was some shakeups on the lead side, and then Josh Sawyer kind of got called in to finish it. He was like the finisher on Neverwinter Nights 2. And I remember like these emails, literally every week an email would come out, he's like, sent from Josh, it would be like, we are cutting this and this, you know, today on the chopping block, this feature. It was every week or two. Or every week, you know, sometimes even more than that, you know, we were cutting a lot of stuff, but it had to be done. Like there was just, we couldn't do all the things that we had wanted to do. And the story, if you've played through it, was huge.
Oh yeah.
Like it wasn't, people often talk about like act one of that dragging a little bit. A lot of that was because it was just a very overambitious design and there wasn't enough time to make any of the stuff great. So it ended up like the orc caves. Well, sorry, all we have time to do is just pop in a gazillion orc encounters and have fun, players. So what should have happened was we should have been looking at that ahead of time and been like, okay, you know, what can we really get done here? How can we cut this down? But again, I think I came in a little late, but you know, it was one of those cases of the design was there where they were trying to do it. There was a deadline, and we sort of didn't have time to give it that critical eye that it really needed. Mm-hmm. And instead, we were just like, get it done, and we're out the door. And then we're like, oh, crap. So, yeah.
Yeah, I remember some of the stuff in that game. I think that was one of the ones with the strongholds, right? And people, I guess, enjoyed the stronghold, and then held that against everybody else that didn't have the strong. I've always kind of been ambivalent about strongholds, to be honest. I kind of feel like, you know, do we really need all this stuff? I mean, it's at some points it starts to feel like it sort of grafting on elements that probably take a lot more investment to build than are really worth it.
So, two things about that. First of all, Neverwinter Nights 2 actually originally had two strongholds. So you were going to get, talk about overscope, you were going to get
two strongholds. Okay.
Oh, yeah. You were going to get a starter stronghold. You were going to have a starter stronghold in the city and like build that up. And then you were going to get Crossroad Keep. Then, of course, obviously we cut down. We were like, we can't do two strongholds because we're like 3/4 of the way through production and haven't even started on it yet. So it became Crossroad Keep. But one thing that I think a lot of people come back to is the strongholds in Baldur's Gate 2. Like, personally, I think that was the best a stronghold has ever been done. And if you really look at that, really what those strongholds were was more narrative. It was more story and more content. Mm-hmm. It wasn't really so much like, I am going to build a wall, or the Western Wall, and the Eastern Wall, and I'm going to hire, like, a guy to, I don't know, make pants for me. Like, that's not really what... that's not what the Baldur's Gate.
Wow.
That's not what they were all about, right? Like it was much more, you know, you're like the one of the ones I love, the Mage Stronghold in Baldur's Gate 2, right? Like you get this weird planar sphere, and then these apprentices show up, and then instead of like hiring people and building stuff, you're saying, hey, apprentice number one, I want to have you try to make something for me, and I want you to go and learn this stuff. And then they would potentially die if you did the wrong thing. But it was like this really cool little narrative experience. Yeah. It wasn't so much like the building. It wasn't like adding a whole new bunch of systems to the game. It was using what was already there, and that was what the strongholds were based upon. I love that. Like, I think that is what a lot of these games should have done instead of sort of trying to take like an RTS and jam it into an RPG.
Yeah, I'm with you 100%. I know this will be a recurring theme, I'm sure, but the idea of fitting into a coherent narrative and having a coherent theme and having all the gameplay always coming back to that instead of just feeling... I'll never forget, I think it was one of the Dragon Age games, and I was like going through curtain options. You know, at some point. I'm like, what the hell am I doing?
Yeah.
I'm picking out curtains? I mean, what is this?
Yeah,
is the Crossing Sims or something? What?
Yeah, I don't know where that started. Like I said, Baldur's Gate 2 did a really good job of it, and then somebody at some point was like, we need a stronghold in our RPG, and we're going to, like, have you picking out curtains and, like, hiring tailors. Like, I don't know where that came from.
Well, it really needs to stop. I've noticed even on a lot of the Kickstarters, too, it gets offered as a one of the stretch goals, and I'm almost like, that's almost an incentive for me not to help them reach the stretch goal, because I don't want, I just don't want to see it.
Well, we could talk about stretch goals when we get to Torment. I got some stuff to say about that. but yeah, you're absolutely right. A lot of teams, especially when there's a fair amount of money coming in, they'll kind of be like, we got to add stretch goals. How about a crafting system? Do we need a crafting system? Nope, not really going to add to the fun of the game, but there it is anyway. And it happens a lot.
Yeah, it's just that bullet point.
Yeah.
You know, I'd rather just not have it in there than have some sort of half-baked, you know, grafted on item.
Yep. Yeah, focus on your core gameplay and your core storytelling and make that as great as it can. And, like, if there are stretch goals that can support that, do it. But, like, don't try to add, like, other kinds of games in, like, a lot of fans aren't even going to care. It's like, as an RPG player, man, I just want a good story and, like, some great choices and consequences, and I don't care about picking out curtains. It doesn't matter. It's not epic.
Epic!
And that's all for this week's episode. Hope you guys and gals enjoyed that. Should be back next week with a third slice of this interview with Mr. Ziets. A lot of great stuff coming up. I mean, we're just scratching the surface. We haven't even got into his masterpiece yet, so stay tuned. A lot of great stuff. The best is yet to come. And as always, I want to thank you very, 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 very much with eternal gratitude and much admiration for your support. Believe me, I am extremely grateful to you for keeping these episodes coming, keeping these interviews coming. I mean, we've heard from so many people over the years, and I couldn't have done it without you. So thank you so much for your kindness, your support. If you want to support the show, go to the Patreon site in the show notes, $1 per episode. You know, if that sounds like a fair price for these clips, or a fair price for these shows, might feel like clips sometimes. Just go to that link in the show notes to the Patreon site, and you can sign up for whatever amount you're comfortable with, whatever it is. I really appreciate it. Also, really appreciate it when you tell other people about the show, you're posting it on forums and things, blogs, tweeting, sharing the tweets, retweeting, posting about it on Facebook. And I like to search sometimes to see the people mentioning the show, and I'm always happy to see those, like Ant, who's always posting on the morning, or what is it, Blues News? And I got a couple of folks like that that are just regular posters on things like Reddit. So really just want to, you know, send a shout out, appreciation for that. Believe me, I do see that, and thank you very much for that. All right, what about the news from the Mad Cave? All right, quite a few things I had to dig up. You know, it seemed like kind of a quiet week at first, and then I dug a little deeper, kind of went to some other sites I don't normally go to, and found out about a few projects I wanted to share with you. First up is the Book of Travels. This is a quote-unquote serene online RPG, like walking into a painting, it's described. Venture out into a hand-painted fairy tale world and become part of a collaborative and friendly role-playing experience. Inspired by the genre classics, this is an online adventure that sets you adrift in an intricate fairy tale world. Without the restraints of linear quests and plot lines, no plot to deal with, an online RPG that focuses more on role-playing and personality than on stats and numbers. So they're running a Kickstarter for this. They've got, they're trying to get, 25,000? And they've already hit 135,000 with 2 weeks left to go on the clock. I mean, that's pretty phenomenal. They've obviously tapped a nerve there somehow, tapped into something. So anyway, go check it out, Book of Travels. You know, tell me what you think about that. And then Kane sent this in. Good old Kane. This is a game called Ratrropolis. I think I know why he sent this to me. I actually got quite a few of you sending me links to this. This is a real-time card game that uses cards to defend a rat city against enemies. You must defend your upcoming enemies with quickness and swiftness, I think that says. Build your own Ratrropolis with various cards you get from playing the game. Become the clan leader for a small rat outpost. And defend from predators and monstrous creatures. So it looks pretty cool. They're describing it as Think Kingdom New Age, but with cards. Real deck building card game. Lead cute rats, not feral cats. So that's in early access on Steam for $15. Love the motif on that. And then finally, I thought this was just really, really cool. This is Eye of the Beholder, but it's on the Commodore 64. If you can believe that, it's incredible. So I was reading about this over at Indie Retro News. This upcoming Dungeon Crawler conversion has got its first intro, so they're showing the intro segments for it. But they, you know, take a look here. They got all sorts of stuff. So what is it? Does it run okay on the C64? Yes. Squeezed it onto a C64 cartridge that you can run on a stock machine. The current build has tested, including 100% of the levels, the traps, monsters, items, featuring high-quality graphics and soundtrack, just like the original game. Could be one of the most amazing releases ever seen on the C64. I would agree. I mean, if they're actually able to pull this off, you know, I will just be floored by this. I mean, who would have thought this would be possible on the Commodore 64? But anyway, definitely keeping an eye on that. And that was over at Indie Retro News. And then finally, I have posted, hopefully some of these will still be available by the time I post this, but I ordered 10, I've got 9, one of them arrived damaged, but anyway, I got 10 copies of Dungeons & Desktops that I want to basically sell to you. if you haven't got the book yet or you want to send it as a gift to somebody. So I'm putting these 9 copies on eBay, signing it, and including one of these Matt Chat coins by the awesome Robbie, the resident artist here at Matt Chat. So you get the coin, you get the book, you also get a collectible pouch, which unfortunately I don't think I brought with me here, but it's got a little black silk bag that goes along with this. You can see the pictures on eBay. So anyway, basically for the same price, you could get this on Amazon. You could get it from me personally, signed with the collectible coin. So I think that's a pretty fabulous deal, but there's only a very limited number, so you need to act quickly on that. And I set up the eBay, so it's a fixed price, and also if you are international, so if you don't live in the U.S., you can still get it, and it's just, you know, you'll deal with eBay's global shipping, and their global shipping partner, I think is how to phrase that. So anyway, they'll take care of that, so all I have to do is just mail it to them, and then they'll take it from there, which I think is really cool for everybody involved. Probably a lot cheaper, too. Anyway, I'll post a link to that auction in the show notes as well. It's not really an auction, but you know what I'm saying. All right, one other thing before we wrap up here. I was at the Minnesota's largest candy store a couple weeks ago, and I found this Jelly Belly Pet Rat fruit flavored gummy candy. I know a lot of you guys are kind of missing the L segments I used to do. So in lieu of that, I'll see about this Pet Rat. So this is by Jelly Belly. Maybe I don't really want to read the instructions. Oh, that's pretty funny. They actually include some care and handling instructions here. I'll see if I can show you this. Probably going to have to take a picture of it. Well, let's see. Care and handling. Handling. Don't be afraid to hold your pet rat. It's been trained not to bite. Oh, I might bite it. Your pet rat has a very thin coat of oil to keep it shiny and from getting sticky, so be careful not to let it slip out of your hands. I'm starting to wonder, this is a candy, right? Okay. Housing. Pet rats like cool, dry places. Too much heat will cause them to melt. So don't leave your pet rat out in the sun. Check. And don't ever get them wet. 3. Collecting. Want to add to your pet rat collection? Pet rats are available in cherry, orange, and grape. Try a different flavor and make a new friend. Or expand your pet gummy collection with a pet gator, pet dinosaur, or pet tarantula, if you can believe it. Wow. Okay, anyway, let's get this open. I don't know if I'll eat the whole thing, but we'll definitely try it. Sorry. Oh, we got some more stuff inside here. Wow, they really went to town on this. Whoa, there we go. There's our rat. Yeah, just looking on the back of this, I don't know if this is a sticker. Fun facts. A rat can last longer without water than a camel. Even very large rats can fit through very tiny spaces. How tiny? Well, let's put it this way. If you have a hole about the size of a coin in your wall, a rat could squeeze through it. Rats don't have bones. They're made up of cartilage, which is flexible. Good to know. Rats can hold their breath for 3 minutes and can tread water for 3 days. Holy cow. Rats multiply so quickly that in 18 months, two rats could have over 1 million descendants. Wow. Okay. My appreciation. I didn't think I could appreciate rats less than I do, but wow. Okay, so here we go. He's kind of like... It's kind of weird. Look at that. It's kind of translucent. Like it's... Ooh. I don't know. A little freaked out by this. It's kind of like that silly putty. You know, so I'm wondering, should I go for the head? Ozzy Osbourne style? Oh, why not? You know, it smells very grapey. Smells good. All right, here we go. Just for you guys. Wow. I'm squirming in there. I don't want to stay down. Chewy. They're kind of good, though. Headless rat. Once you get past the gumminess, a lot of flavor there. Very grapey. You know, this isn't bad at all. I bet you could really have a lot of fun with this, too, just freaking people the heck out. Can you imagine a guy walking around like this? Ooh. Okay. That is quite tasty. And I got to say, if you want to get some attention, man. Wow, pet rat. Candy. Oh, that's just messed up on so many levels. Oh, okay. All right, let's wrap it up with a quote. And I'm going to go with this quote. I was looking up for quotes about, you know, doing more with less, not trying to just keep adding on to something, sort of knowing when you're done, and stuff along those lines. And I'm not quite sure this fits, but I thought this was a really fun sentiment, really fun story. It's by Plutarch from his book Plutarch's Lives, Volume 1. It goes something like this. When someone blames Hecateus, the sophist, because that being invited to the public table, he had not spoken one word all supper time. Archidamidas answered in his vindication, he who knows how to speak knows also when. All right, so ponder on that and see you guys next time.
Cornerstone of English scholarship. This- This book, sir, contains every word in our beloved language.
Every single one, sir?
Every single word, sir.
Oh, well, in that case, sir, I hope you will not object if I also offer the doctor my most enthusiastic contrafibularities.